In this video, I'll be introducing the differential of a smooth map. Let's get right into the definition. So first of all, what is the concept of the differential? Well, the differential will be able to operate on any smooth map which goes between two smooth manifolds. Now the concept's name, which is differential, kind of should make you think that it will involve derivatives or the derivations that we considered last time. And it actually will, because what it will do is for any P, which is a point of the domain manifold, it will construct a brand new linear map, DF at P, which will be between TPM and T. Well, we can't use P here. The only other operation we have is F, and so it'll be T at F of P, N. And so what it is a linear map that takes you between the two tangent spaces with corresponding base points. How do I define this? If I do DFP, I'm able to apply this to a derivation on M. Let's go ahead and say it's W. Then this will output a derivation on N. And so then I can apply any derivation on N to a function F. And this function F will take you from N down to R. Now we have three different objects to work with here. We have F, W, and big F. How exactly do I define the real number that pops out of this? Well, one of these objects always outputs a real number, and it is W. W is the derivation in the group. And so if we utilize W as the thing that finally makes it go down to the real numbers, then it will probably act as a derivation. Now what we need to put into W is something that goes from the domain manifold M down to R. And this is because W is an element of TPM. Now, how do I come up with that? Well, I know that there is a function little f that goes from N down to R. And I know that there's a function big F, which goes from M to N. So if I just compose those two, little f composed big F, then I am able to get what I wanted, namely a map that takes you from M down to R, and so I can apply that derivation. Now, it's pretty easy to verify that this is in fact outputting derivations. I will verify the product rule. You can very easily, by the same methods I use, verify that it's linear. So if I do DFP applied to W, I want to check that this is a derivation in itself. So it has to obey the product rule. So I'm applying it to F times G. This is equal to, by definition, W of F times G composed big F, which then, by the definition of the product of two functions, is equal to W of F composed big F times G composed big F. Then W is a derivation, and right here we have the product of two different functions. So we can use W's product rule. W of F composed big F times G composed big F is equal to W of F composed big F times G composed big F applied to P. Now, why am I applying it to P? Again, W is coming from TPM. That's our base point, P. Then we go ahead and add W of G composed big F times F composed big F applied to P. What is this equal to? Well, by definition, W of F composed big F is just D big F P applied to W acting on F. Then, by the definition of composition, this is equal to G of F of P. Then, the other term is going to be D big F P applied to W acting on G times, well, little f of big F of P. Now you can go ahead and see how this choice of base point in N actually makes sense, because it shows up right here in our product rule. And so we know that this is a derivation at big F of P, because it obeys the product rule. Now that we know that this is a well-defined function, let's go ahead and prove some properties about it. What I'll do is specify here that F is a smooth map from M to N, and that G is a smooth map from N to N prime, and we have some point that is an element of M. So the first property is that DFP is linear. The second property is that D applied to G composed F at P is going to be equal to DG at F of P composed DF at P. The third property is going to be that D of the identity on M at some point P is going to be equal to the identity on the tangent space TPM. And then four is that if F is a diffeomorphism, then DFP is an isomorphism, and its inverse is going to be D at F inverse at F of P. Now that first property is very, very easy, so I won't prove it. The second property is a bit more difficult. So if I do D at G composed F at some point P, well, I can apply this to some derivation W and have it act on a function F. This is, by definition, W of little f composed G composed big F. Now I'm going to use the associative property to prove that this is equal to W of quantity F composed G end quantity composed big F. Now you can see we have some function, namely little f composed g, composed big F, and a derivation applied to it. That is, by definition, the differential of big F at P applied to W acting on F composed big G. But now you can see we have some derivation dFP of W applied to little f composed big G. And so that is, by definition, dG at, well, it's going to be at f of p. Why? Because this is a derivation at f of p. So we have dG at f of p. We're applying this to the derivation dFp of w. And then we're having this act on f. Now, if I just rearrange the parentheses a little bit, we have it that it is the composition of the two differentials. And so that is a presentation of its functorality, meaning it preserves composition. Now, three is actually extraordinarily easy to prove, so I'll just leave it to you. Now, four is going to be also easy to prove, because all you need to do is show that D at F inverse at F of P is going to be a two-sided inverse of DFP. Now this is obvious because of 2. So let's go ahead and see how it is a left inverse. So I do DF inverse at F of P composed DFP. Now by 2, this is going to be equal to, going backwards here, from here to there, D at F inverse composed F at P, which is then going to be equal to, by the definition of inverse, D at the identity on M at P, which then by 3, which is very easy to prove, we just get the identity at the tangent space. And so we get that this is a left inverse, and then you can also prove that it's a right inverse, and anything that is a two-sided inverse is bijective. That's the end of the proof of all four properties. All right, what do we do with all of this information? Well, it actually proves some properties that might not seem immediately obvious. Namely, the theorem that says for any open submanifold U of your smooth manifold M, and any P, which is an element of U, and thus also an element of M, d iota at P, where iota is the inclusion map, the one that sends every element of U to itself in M, will be an isomorphism between TPU and TPM. Well, we know by 1 that this is a linear map. And so if I want to prove that this is an isomorphism, I just have to prove that it's bijective, which means I can prove that it's injective and surjective. Now, to prove that it's injective, all I have to do is show that for any W, which is in TPU, we only have it that d iota p applied to w is equal to 0 if w is 0. Now I'm going to have to prove that second part, How do I get there? Well, the way we get there is actually by applying it to specific functions f. And this is for any function f which takes you from m down to r, because the image of di iota is in TPM. So now we're going to use concepts that were developed alongside partitions of unity. So if you have not seen manifolds 3.1, 3.2, and 3.3, well then go ahead and watch those before watching this, because it uses extensions and smooth bump functions, which you might not know about unless you watch them. What we're going to do is, given our point P, we're going to construct some open ball around it, B, which is then contained in its closure by the fact that a manifold is locally compact, is going to be an element of our open neighborhood U. Go ahead and see manifolds 1.4 for that. Now, given these sets, in some smooth map F, which takes you from U down to R, I will be able to generate an extension of that function F tilde, which will take you from the full manifold M down to R. And the fact that it's an extension will not work on just any open subset. We have to rely on closed subsets. And so we will say that F tilde restricted to B bar is equal to F restricted to B bar. What this means is that they agree on B. So they agree on some open neighborhood. What I will prove in the following lemma is that if any two functions agree on some open neighborhood, say f and g agree on u, an open neighborhood, then we have it that wf is equal to wg for any derivation w. And note that this u is a neighborhood around a selected point p, and w is a derivation at p, at whatever manifold m. This m is an arbitrary one, it's not necessarily the one we're dealing with in this theorem. How do I prove this? Well, the way we prove it is by smooth bump functions. Let's go ahead and take h to be f minus g. Now this function h will be zero whenever f is equal to g, whenever f agrees on g, meaning that the support of h is actually important in discussing the relationship between f and g. Now we have an idea of how to construct smooth bump functions from the support of smooth functions like h. Let's go ahead and say psi is a smooth bump function, and we have it that psi is 1 on the support of h, and that the support of psi itself is going to be contained entirely within m removing p. By manifolds 3.3, we will be able to generate such a smooth bump function. I've designed it so that psi times h is equal to h. Why is this? Well, because psi is going to be 1 on the support of h, which means psi is 1 whenever h is not 0. Whenever h is non-zero, psi is equal to 1, and then you have 1 times h is equal to h. And whenever h is 0, well then you get 0 times something else is 0, which is then h. And so you get psi times h is equal to h, and so we are able to use w of psi times h is going to be equal to w of h, but let's go ahead and do the product rule instead, so that we'd have w of psi times h of p plus w of h times psi of p. But then we know that h of p has to be equal to 0, because f and g agree on that neighborhood of p. And so that means that h goes to 0, and thus this product goes to 0. But then psi of p has to be equal to 0, because we designed it that the support of psi does not include p. So that goes to 0 as well. So this entire thing is equal to 0, which is then equal to w of h. And h, of course, is equal to f minus g. And so we get that w of f is equal to w of g by linearity. Now that we've proved this lemma, let's go ahead and prove injectivity once and for all. So let's go ahead and do w of f, w of our arbitrary function f. This is going to be equal to, by lemma 3, w of f tilde restricted to u. Because again, they agreed on some neighborhood around p. And so w is the same on both. And we can't do f tilde on the entirety of m, because w is in TPU. So now that we have that, this is going to be equal to, by the definition of restriction, f tilde composed iota. But w of f tilde composed iota is just equal to, by definition, d iota at p of w applied to f tilde. But then, you can see right here, d iota p of w applied to anything is equal to zero. And so we got that w of any function is equal to zero, which means that w is zero, which then means it is injective. Now let's go ahead and prove surjectivity. Now a map is going to be surjective if for any w, which you take in TPM, there exists a v in TPU that maps onto it. Now let me go ahead and define this v by saying that v applied to a function f is just going to be w applied to the extension of that function. W applied to f tilde, as we defined f tilde beforehand. So we take this function on u and we extend it so that they agree on b. Let's go ahead and see what d iota p applied to v actually is. Well, this is, by definition, going to be v of f composed iota, which is then going to be equal to, by definition, w of f composed iota extended, which is then going to be equal to w of f. Why is that? Well, remember, this is an extension which agrees on f composed tilde on b. And so because it agrees with f composed tilde on b, it also agrees with f on b. And then by lemma 3, we have it that they're equal to each other. And so we get that the image of v is w, and thus we have it surjective. All right, what can we do with this information, that TPU is isomorphic to TPM? Well, hopefully you can see that we can then prove that TPM is an n-dimensional vector space. Why is this? Why does this guarantee that TPM is an n-dimensional vector space? Well, let's go ahead and say we have some chart phi u, which is around some point p in M. Then I can go ahead and construct the map T phi inverse. Remember, that's because phi is a diffeomorphism at the point phi of p. So this is the inverse of d phi at p. So this inverse map is going to take you from the tangent space at phi of p of u hat, the open subset of Rn, which is mapped onto via phi, and it'll map this isomorphically, because this is a diffeomorphism, and by 4, map it isomorphically into TPU. Then I know from the previous theorem, theorem 2, that TPU is isomorphic to TPM via d iota p. And in a similar way, we know that d iota prime p, and I'm using iota prime to just be the inclusion of u hat into Rn, and this is going to be an isomorphism between t phi of p u hat and t phi of p Rn. And so if we use this and this, we get that TPM is isomorphic to t phi of p Rn. And so because of last video, we know that this is an n-dimensional vector space, so is TPM. What is the basis then of TPM? Well, we know what the basis on t phi of p Rn is. It's going to be the collection of del on del xi evaluated at phi of p. And because of lemma 3, we can basically make it so that there's no distinguishing between t phi of p u hat and t phi of p Rn, and similarly between TPU and TPM. Because as long as they agree on an open neighborhood, namely the open neighborhoods of u and u hat, it will be the same exact derivation. We can basically treat these del on del xi's as a basis element of t phi of p u hat, instead of as a basis element of t phi of p Rn. So that means if I just map them via our isomorphism d phi inverse at phi of p, applied to this basis element, del n del xi, evaluated at phi of p, this will be a basis element of TPU. And by extension, it will also be a basis element of TPM because of lemma 3. All right, what is this equal to when I apply it to some function f? Well, by definition, this is del on del xi evaluated at f of p, and we're applying this to f composed phi inverse. All right, what is this equal to? This is equal to del on del xi of f composed phi inverse. We're applying that at phi of p. I will represent this as just del on del xi evaluated at p applied to f. This is a notation. This will represent this. And what we're doing here is implicitly implying that phi I, the ith coordinate of this chart, is xi. And so if you want to change coordinates to some other coordinate chart, you will represent it by some other variable than x. And so as a feature of notation, we represent this del of f composed phi inverse over del xi applied to phi of p as just del on del xi evaluated at p of f, which I will also write del f on del xi evaluated at p. Even though this doesn't actually make any sense, it is a notational variant of this. So, we finally figured it out. The tangent space on M is an n-dimensional vector space. Note too that this is the coordinate representation of the function f. So we ended up finding out that the basis of TPM is just the partial derivative of the coordinate representation of f evaluated at the coordinate representation of p. And so it is very much directly analogous to the tangent space on Rn. And so that satisfies our criteria for the tangent space we laid out in the previous video. As a review, the differential is a way we can convert from a smooth map to a linear map between the tangent spaces. We proved that such is well-defined. We proved good properties about it. We proved that an open submanifold has an isomorphic tangent space to the manifold where it came from. We proved that if two functions agree on an open neighborhood, that when you apply derivations to them, they are equal to each other. And we proved, finally, that TPM is an n-dimensional vector space. Anyway, that's it.